So our next presenter is Dr. Peter Jodiskens, who's an expert on meteor showers and author of the 790-page tome, Meteor Showers and Their Parent Comets, which predicts good meteor showers for the next 50 years. So gives an indication of, well, no, keep on, don't run away. Peter is best known for his recovery of fragments of asteroid 2008 TC3, which you heard about a little bit earlier, and has also dived right into the Chelyabinsk region in Russia shortly after the 2013 incident that we've also talked about. So please welcome Peter Jodiskens.
Thank you. We've been talking about asteroids, and they sound like something far away, distant, and remote. But you'd be surprised. This is a little bit of an asteroid. It's called a meteorite. And this could be sitting in your backyard as we speak. This rock was in space 30 years ago on its course, doing its thing, going around the sun. And at one point, it suddenly saw this massive planet in front of it, impacted the Earth's atmosphere, became really hot, and a little bit survived and ended up landing on the ground. How do you recognize a meteorite? Not because it's heavy, not because it's black, definitely not because it's magnetic. Keep your magnets away from these rocks, please. You recognize these rocks because they have gone through the Earth's atmosphere and became really hot. And they were sort of flash heated. And you can see that because the rock has a thin crust, a black crust on it. And it's really a crust, it's not a veneer, it's not a, the weather changing the surface, it's really a thin layer of glass that surrounds this whole rock. So if you go in your garden and you check out all the rocks that might be sitting there, don't look for whether the rock is heavy, or don't look for whether it has metal in it, or whether it's dense, or whether it attracts a magnet. Look for this fusion crust, this rock of glass. Now, why do you get this glass, you might say? Well, do you have any idea how fast we are moving at the moment? Did you just hear Dave Morrison's talk? I mean, this little piece of space here, do you realize that in 6 minutes, Europe is passing by here? We are moving at 30 kilometers per second. What is it, about 20 miles per second going around the sun? In a single second, in 2 seconds from here to San Jose? That's as fast as things are moving in space. And so that's the sort of speed in which these rocks are coming in the Earth's atmosphere. If you're going that fast, you get hot very quickly. And the air blows away all the melted material, and so you just end up with a thin layer of melt across the rock. So the heat wave doesn't really penetrate the rock, it's not enough time. So this is what you get. Your rock in your garden may be a meteorite, may be in space. Now why is that as interesting? Let me tell you about my vacation stories. I was in Russia 3 weeks after the Chelyabinsk impact. And it was an incredible privilege. I was invited to take part in the Russian Academy of Sciences field study of Chelyabinsk. We went to Chelyabinsk, we went to the city that was just experienced an impact of a 20 meter size asteroid. How do we? How does this work? No. Just put it down. I'll say next slide. So I was in Chelyabinsk. The city just got literally impacted by an asteroid. This thing was captured while it was still moving in the sky by one of the people in Chelyabinsk. It's amazing. He had a photographic camera in his hand. He saw this fireball in the sky. He took a picture. You see the sun rising there, it was very early in the morning. And suddenly there was this this massive fireball in the sky. This thing was a 20-meter size rock. It's about 20 yards in diameter, coming in at 19.2 kilometers in a second. 19.2 kilometers in a second. So just the motion of it carried energy of 500 kilotons of TNT equivalent. So in other words, 40 Hiroshima bombs went off over Chelyabinsk. And what that did was it created this, massive airburst. This is a picture us showing the dust cloud as it was seen left behind by the meteoroid. It was at the point, the end of this trajectory where you see this big billowing going up. That's where the rock fragmented in pieces and where all that energy in motion was dumped in the atmosphere. Next slide. This shows you that moment of breakup just a few seconds later, and you can still see the glowing material. This is the first time we've ever seen that. There's just so much energy deposited that the air and all the debris is glowing from where this happened. We did a lot of efforts to determine where that was, how high up in the atmosphere that was. And this cloud of debris ultimately settled a little bit above 26 kilometers high up. So we went to the area, and most of the effort we did was to try and then map out the damage that was done by this shockwave. And here we are interviewing people in the local markets, asking them what they experienced, the heat they experienced, the sound waves. Next. We visited the locations where people said that damage had occurred. So this was one of the furthest schools that we met, and you can see the windows being broken at two sides. That's where the shockwave came in and broke the glass. Next slide. This is sort of an overview. The asteroid came in here. This at the bottom is Kazakhstan, up there is Russia. The asteroid came in at about 99 kilometers high, moved that direction. And then at some point, at about 30 kilometers high, it broke into pieces. And that's where this massive shockwave was created. And all the red and orange points is where we found buildings with that glass damage. And you can see we had to drive 90 kilometers away from the trajectory and we're still finding buildings with broken glass. So this was a massive blast wave that went out. If you look at the videos, the glass was shattered into a spray of pieces. The whole window frames were being pushed in at the places close to the trajectory. People were literally blown off their feet by this airburst. This was so intense that 1,200 people went to the hospital asking for medical treatment, mostly from flying glass, it was said. Now, this event was not so big, not like Tunguska, where nothing was found. And those found on where the yellow plots are. So most of the material is from the moment the rock broke up and was stopped in the atmosphere. A couple pieces continued on, two big pieces continued on, one survived, and at the end landed up in Lake Chipaku, actually cut a hole in the ice. Next. Yeah. So this was seen from above, nice spherical hole. This was actually an impact crater. We have video showing the moment the rock hit the ice. Little cloud of ice is being blown up, and then the wind blows that ice cloud away. The Russians went in, they dug out of the mud a 6-kilogram chunk of rock. Next slide. It's now displayed in the museum, exactly. Yeah, next slide. When I was there, there was no chance to go look for meteorites. That wasn't our purpose. But we did want to know where the meteorites fell. So we asked the locals to tell them where they found the meteorites, and even kids found them all there in the towns and in the villages, in the snow. Next slide. Why did we want to look at these meteorites? Well, the meteorites gives you clues as to why the asteroid did what it did. Why did it break apart at, above about 30 kilometers altitude? These are some of the pieces we were shown by the various locals. Alessandrovska was very close to where the impact happened, and then Bezunyaki was further down the range. So the further you went down the range, the bigger the chunks were. They're hard to stop.
So you're blocking the view for that.
Yeah, oh, sorry. So, next slide. Sorry about that. I have to stand on stage, apparently. Okay, so can I have a way to come to the slides, because this is annoying. Do I have a Dumaflots or something that moves the slides?
Just the arrows.
Okay.
Right.
All right, okay. All right, so this is one of those meteorites that were found from Chelyabinsk, and you see the crust around it. That's again from the rock going through the air very fast. But what's fascinating, if you look at this rock in the crust cut, is all these cracks in it. And those are basically called shock veins. We think that is what contributed to the weakness of the Chelyabinsk impactor. And that may have contributed to why this rock fragmented the way it did. And that's the sort of information that's really important if in the future we want to predict what is going to happen next. So this was the trajectory in which Chelyabinsk came in. And Chelyabinsk is a particular meteorite type. It's called an LL gondrite. And this was the very first time that we actually had a track on how this asteroid was going around the sun and on what orbit it was hitting the Earth. So this thing came from the direction of the sun. It was moving towards the Earth from the sun side, and hit Chelyabinsk just on the day side of the planet. This is where these meteorites are coming from debris fields in the asteroid belt. If you see the next slide. This little animation is gives you a sense of the asteroid belt itself. So we have the sun here in the center. Here's Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. And then here's the orbit of Jupiter. All these green points are asteroids. Those are all the asteroids we've discovered. And this is, by the way, a slide from 2002. So at the moment, there's a lot more. The red ones are the ones that move in orbits that come close to us. And some of these go all the way back here and then come all the way in like this, while others are going in a more circular orbit. But this is the region where all these asteroids originate. Next. So if you take a side view of that, then this is how the asteroid belt looks from the side. So Jupiter is now here, and then here's all the various asteroids with the sun in the center. If you sort of think of this as a cloud there, so here's the asteroid belt, the sun is in the center. Just look at this top part here. Look at sort of the steepness in which the asteroids are moving, and look at the distance away that they're away from the sun. In reality, of course, we look at how steep are the asteroids moving, that's plotted that way, and that way is what the orbital period is, how long does it take for the asteroid to go around the sun. That shows you a diagram like this. And what you see here is, these are the asteroids for which colors have been measured, so what we know what color they have, what type they are. And you see that they come in groups, these are called asteroid families. And these groups are these collisions. That's where asteroids collided with each other and created a debris field. It's these debris fields that are giving us our meteorites. So what at the moment we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out where did the Chelyabinsk meteorite come from? And where do other meteorites come from? We think, based on the orbit of Chelyabinsk and its evolution, that Chelyabinsk came from this group at the inside of a resonance called the NU6 resonance here. So we think that Chelyabinsk came from here. But that's the exercise we're doing at the moment. Now, these impacts happen all the time. This is a map showing all the various impacts that happened on the Earth that were seen from space in this period of time. you can see, you know, we get bombarded every night. These are rocks, you know, meter in size, a few meters in size. The really big one was Chelyabinsk here at 20 meters. These are fairly big fireballs in the sky, fairly big impacts. And one of these happened in California when we were, not so long ago, in 2012. And that fireball was also caught by, in this case, Lisa Warren, who had a digital camera in her hand. She saw the fireball in the sky. She immediately pointed up and took pictures of it. And this is the picture she took. And if you zoom in on this, then you can actually see that this is all the debris from the asteroid breaking in the atmosphere. This is where the asteroid broke. It came down, and this is this whole cloud of debris coming down. And that cloud of debris was seen falling down by Doppler weather radar. So this is a picture showing the area in Gold Country, here in the Sierra Nevada, where these rocks were seen coming down. The blue is that Doppler weather radar signature, and the red is where meteorites were later found on the ground. If you live in this area, then I'm almost certain there was a meteorite sitting in your backyard. at least there's a good chance. A lot of people went looking for these. In the end, we found 77. So 77 of these were found. Turned out to be really interesting meteorites. And this is how it looked like. It was very black. Again, there was fusion crust. Some of these had this ridge of crust on the side. And it turned out to be a CM-type carbonaceous chondrite. This is really cool type of material because this is the sort of meteorites that we think brought the carbon atoms and the water in your body to the Earth. So the people who study origin of life processes are really interested in these. They want to know what's in it. They want to have it as pristine as possible, not contaminated. So don't touch these. Use a piece of aluminum foil, for example, to collect this rock. You know, don't touch it. It turns out that the meteorites, I found a piece on the parking lot in Lotus Park. That piece, I collected in aluminum foil. I showed it to some people, you know, I was very excited finding it. That thing was already for 80% just by people breathing on it. the rocks that were found and then went into trade and made it into the museums were completely contaminated. So please, you know, take this rock very carefully. The rocks are not a problem for you. You are a problem for the rocks. So you want to keep the rocks as clean as you can. And that, from the video imaging that we had and from the photographs, we were able to get an orbit of this thing. And this rock came from almost the orbit of Jupiter all the way in to just inside the orbit of Venus, close to Mercury's orbit. Very eccentric orbit, low inclined in the plane of the planets. What this tells us is that this rock came from somewhere low inclined area, and it came from this 3-to-1 resonance, because that corresponds to the orbital period of these rocks. And we now think that this rock came from this area here. Again, because it's the only region that we know of, the only debris field, that's a good candidate source region for these CM chondrites. And then this next one is another incredible fall happened here just down the road in the town of Novato. If you live in Novato or in Sonoma, you know, this rock could be sitting in your backyard. It was incredibly well photographed by, again, a person who had a camera in his hand, Bob Marino in Santa Rosa. And we also got this one captured in our meteor surveillance. So we're doing a meteor surveillance of the night sky here in the Bay Area, where we map out all the meteor showers. And this is the track that we calculated. So the meteor came from over the ocean, came down, just hit land inwards, and went over the town of Novato. And this is the picture that I put in the newspaper in a story written by Dave Pullman. As you see, you know, Novato was in our smack in our area. That paper sort of made Lisa Weber remember that she had heard something hit the roof of her garage. She heard sort of a tok 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 sound. She went looking to see if she had raccoons in the garage, but you know, everything was in place. But when she read the newspaper story, she thought, I better check this out. So she went in her garden, she looks around in the yard, didn't see anything. Then put up the ladder against the garage, climbed up the ladder, looked on the roof of the garage, didn't see anything. Climbed down the ladder, and at the foot of the ladder, against the fence, was this rock. And when Lisa wrote me a very nice email about it, that evening I drove over to her house. She had to work, but her neighbors were all too glad to show it. And when I was first presented with this rock, I did not think it was a meteorite.
I remember reading that.
Yeah, I had a really hard time believing that because there's no fusion crust on it. There's actually turns out that there are little bits left. There's a little patches here and there, but there's nothing really clearly a fusion crust. Yeah. And so so that evening we decided to investigate further. So Luis Rivera, the neighbor, put the ladder up against the roof of the garage, pretty high garage. Climbed up, was gone for about a minute, and then said, bingo! And he found this little hole in the little dent in the tile. And so something, you know, really hit this roof. So you can see it was a nice divot. And so in hindsight, it turned out that this happened. The fireball came from the south, hit the study here. The meteorite scooted over to the garage, went up into the air, bounced back a couple of times, and then landed right there next to the garage spot. This was one of the other Novato meteorites found. And on this one, you actually can see the fusion crust. You can see this layer there on the side. So that's what you're looking for. In this case, the white material was actually holding on to the fusion crust, but the black material did not. So the black material was already so glassy that it didn't hold on to the glass cover. So, you know, in the...
What type of meteorite?
This was an L6 type of a chondrite, and we think that this one came from the Gephion family. So, in the couple of years that we've now run this video surveillance here in the Bay Area, we have about two or three times a year a fireball that drops something on the ground, we think. We went looking for them. You're free to join us on the searches. But we can never find them because the area that we are searching is huge. The region is still about 10 kilometers long and, you know, several kilometers wide. So to find these things is extremely difficult. So that's why we need your help. Please keep on the lookout when you're hiking, when you walk around, when you check out your garden. Keep an eye out for these rocks and let us know if you find one of these rocks with a black glass crust around it. Thank you.